Creating a stock trading AI is extremely difficult. Most of the time, it isn't going to work until one day it just does. And for the past few months, I've been working on an AI that learns how to buy and sell Apple stock. And if you've seen my past two videos, you know there have been a lot of improvements. AIs aren't stupid or smart. Some are just built better than others. In my case, I've made several changes to my code base here, and let's go through it. We're going to be using stable baselines and Jim Any Trading to train our model. We're going to use Finta for some custom indicators that our model will use to basically make decisions on whether to buy or sell. And Quantstats is new to this video. I've included Quantstats at the end of this code to take a look at how well our code performs. These are the imports. So for the gym that our agent will learn in, we're importing gym. You can read it here. These are the stable baselines that we've included. What you'll see that's new in compared to our other videos is I've created an evaluation callback as well as a stop training on reward threshold. This is going to be useful for saving our data while it's being trained. We're still using the actor to critic model. And then for our quant finance imports, we're going to use Finta for our custom indicators and Quantstats to evaluate how well our model did over a period of time. We'll also just need to access our operating system and then just, you know, the classic granddaddies of data science here. The other thing I did was, if you remember in my other videos, my API key was always blurred out. This is just makes it easier so I don't have to do a whole lot of editing in, you know, post video. The other thing that I did this time, there's probably a more elegant way to go about doing this, but I downloaded 3 months worth of data at intervals of 5 minutes here. Alpha Vantage will only give you back 1 month at a time. So basically, I just called 3 months, got all the data, put it into a CSV, put each CSV into a data frame, and then merged all the data together, and this is what we got. So this is a lot more data than I was pulling in before at this time interval. Before in the other two videos, I think I was only getting 1 month, but now we have three, which is a lot more data for our model to train on and practice on, which should hopefully create better results. And we go ahead and do, you know, similar things. We set the time date as the index, and it's going to return to us open, high, low, close volume. We're going to then sort these values in ascending order. Basically, what that helps us do is instead of putting in, you know, the earliest day for the most recent day at the beginning of our model, we're putting in, you know, the farthest day of that 3 month period into the model first. So we're moving as if we're starting on this day, moving forward at 5 minute intervals. So this was putting the data backwards through the model. So when we reverse it, we're just making the model go in the same direction that we humans go through. Hopefully that makes sense. We also need to rename the data columns just for any trading to work. They need to be titled, basically. And yeah, you can see here that our shape is much bigger than what we usually get. So all this is pretty much the same. Moving on, I've added custom indicators. If you want to, you can go check out the second video in this series, where I go about how you include custom indicators. I don't think I was using these three in that video, but I went back and did RSI, simple moving average, and the OBV here for our custom indicators in this model. And then you'll need to create a function to properly format the data to be passed through the environment. So the environment comes with its default, indicators, and we need to replace that default indicator with our own signals. So the RSI and our data frame with the low open high volume, RSI, simple moving. So when we take a look at our new data, this is what it's going to look like. And then, of course, we replace the default with our new, signals here. And then we initialize that environment, and we're going to do a window size of 100. In the previous videos, I was only doing a window size of like 5 or 10. I don't think that was enough. Initially, it was because we didn't have in enough data. So that's another benefit we're getting from getting 3 months worth of data, is that we can give ourselves a greater window size for our model to explore. And then we're going to do a frame bound of 100 to 9,000. And if you remember, frame bound in this instance just means that the model is going to start with the first 100 window size and move through the data through to 9,000. You can think of that as the training data. And then we create a dummy vector for our environment. And So then at this point, we're creating a reinforcement learning temporary folder in our directory. We're going to save a path to that. We're going to create a callback, and it's going to be called stop training on reward threshold. The reward threshold will be 200. Basically, what this means is that the training will stop when the reward threshold meets this 200 mark. And we'll check the training and evaluate the performance until the threshold is met. So the evaluation callback in our environment is the stop callback that we initialized here. We'll evaluate it every 10,000 steps there, and we'll save the path, the best model save path, to our save path that we've defined here as well. So this is great because now we don't have to monitor our training to make sure that we're getting good results, or if we don't monitor our training, we could basically reach a point where we're getting diminishing returns with each epoch and with each training step. So this will automatically stop it and save our best model in this directory here when it reaches this reward threshold, if it ever reaches this reward threshold. I still need to play around with this because I think when I went through it the first time, the reward threshold was never met. So I need to continue to tinker a little bit, but this helps make the training a lot easier. This is standard from what we've done in the past. We're calling an A2C actor to critic model. We're using the MLP policy, passing through our environment, and we're going to learn on, what is this, a million steps, and then we just make that callback with the evaluation callback that we have initialized up here. It's going to train a bunch. As you can see, I've already gone through the time to train it, and it looks like, you can see here when we have that callback and you're looking at your training, it'll go here the first number of time steps. Episode reward is negative 12 in this instance. Episode length is et cetera, et cetera. So then it saved this model here. So then if we go another 1,000 or so, we should try to find one where we get, here we go. So at evaluation times at 3,000, there was really no change, but it called the length. Let me see if I can find one where it actually saves. There we go. New best mean reward. So the callback that is monitoring our training and is saving when we have a new best mean reward. So that's the benefit of having the callback. I did set up some different models to train. I haven't gotten to that yet. I think that'll be for episode 4 of this series. We're going to try out a PPO as well as a DQN. But I wanted to get this video out because it's been a while since I made that last episode 3. Here we are going to load the best model that we've saved in our directory. And then we're going to reinitialize the custom environment, but this time our window size will be the validation series. So we're keeping the same window size, but the frame bound is going to be data that the model has not seen yet. And then we go ahead and see what happens. And you can see that the total profit here was 1.08. So we made a very, very small position gain. And if we look at our graph, this is what it looks like. So this is where the quant stats comes into play. This is how we can take a look at our reports of full returns. The returns is the net worth PCT change and the index location from the first beginning to the end of the series here. And we're defining the first to the end of the series in our index starting from our same frame size as the one up here. So hopefully that makes sense. But you can see here our strategy now gives us a ton more information that we did not have in the beginning of the in our last few videos. I may need to go back and look through this because a lot of this doesn't make sense. Like, it's only showing me the first month of January, which could be true because we've only done 3 months and then we trained it on the last month, right? So maybe it only did this 1 month and we did pretty good. But if we wanted to get a better idea, we would obviously have to train it more. But you get the idea that when we pull in even more data, say, and we test it on the next, say, you know, if we now that we have it trained, if we pulled in other data from Apple that it hasn't seen another 3 months from now, and we ran it through, that all these reports would give us an idea of what the model is doing and financially how well it's performing. Ideally, you'd want to do it more than 1 month, but you get the idea. So that just about does it to the changes that I've made. I need to think about what other parameters I want to create and ways that I can improve it. Right now I have, obviously we're going to try different models. Like I said before, we're going to try the DQN and the PPO. And I probably need to try to get more data or train the model on different data. Or I'm even considering trying to train the model at a different time frame, because 5 minute intervals requires quite a lot of computational power, just because there's so much of it. Maybe it's too high resolution. In any case, let me know in the comments below what you'd like me to see or where you'd like me to take this model. Hopefully I'll have part 4 out in a couple of weeks. So thanks for watching. I really appreciate it, guys, and take care. Bye.